Hello and welcome to this training on rendering air scrubbers hosted by Chem-Aqua. Today we're going to go over different air scrubber designs for the rendering industry and we'll kind of talk through how they operate, some basic troubleshooting, things like that. I am your presenter today. My name is Eric Schnackenberg. I'm the area manager based out of Omaha, Nebraska. I manage the food and rendering team out here. Today we're going to discuss what are air scrubbers, why are we using them, why do we need them. There's several different designs and styles that you may see in a rendering operation. We'll discuss a little bit about how they work, how to operate them, go through some maintenance and troubleshooting and things like that. First, what are air scrubbers? It's basically any machine designed to scrub the air to remove pollutants. That can be several different things in the rendering industry specifically. We're looking for fats, solids, and odors. In milling, they're looking to get fine particulates. Again, several different designs on these, based on the needs of that industry and that facility. For rendering specifically, there's wet, dry, and kind of flame-based or heat RTO style scrubbers, different designs there. There's also different styles. So we have venturis, high-intensity pack beds, room air scrubbers, RTOs, all sorts of different styles and designs. It's important to understand your facility, how it was set up, and kind of get the general theory on why. Get yourself familiar with your system, because again, there's several different designs and styles to this. They all operate differently based on the needs of the facility, how the system was designed, the products being cooked. Red meat rendering versus poultry rendering may have different styles, different designs on how they operate. A lot of it is also based on government permits and regulations for your area, your state, things like that. Available floor space plays a big factor in how air scrubbers are used. And again, there's just lots and lots of different factors. So it's important to understand your system design, and how it's set up and why. We're going to specifically talk about wet air scrubbers in this training today because that's the most commonly used one in rendering. Wet scrubbers use water to capture the fats, solids, odors, things like that in the rendering process. They are very safe to operate because they generally just use water. Some of them may still have a flame-based RTO style or other final process on the way out to atmosphere as kind of a final polish, but most commonly we see wet scrubbers in animal rendering. A general theory on how they operate is we bring the dirty air in from the cooker or from whatever process. We bring the water in, fresh water is brought in, and they combine in the middle. Water is able to capture odors. It is able to cool the fats and solids so that they drop out into the bottom sump. Water is really, really good at scrubbing the air. So we spray it inside the machine right on top of the gas. There's generally media of some sort in the middle to increase surface area, increase contact time of the water and the gas. And again, these things will fall down to the bottom of the sump and they are then evacuated from the system. It is always a good idea to keep the media, keep the scrubber as clean as possible for best operation. But again, as a general theory, we're just combining water and air inside the machine to cool it and get the stuff out of it or scrub the pollutants out of it. Most of these systems are set up in a daisy chain style environment. It's not always true, but most of the time it'll come off the cooker, go through some sort of condenser or evaporative coil to begin cooling the gases. It will then go through some type of venturi machine to scrub the real heavy stuff, the fats and solids, get most of it out in the venturi. The pack bed then kind of does a secondary polish. And a lot of times that's paired with a room air scrubber, which will continue polishing the process air and also pick up air from different areas around the plant to help keep the indoor air clean. You know, we've seen some where there's only a venturi or there's only pack beds. Sometimes there's two pack beds. Again, a lot of different styles and designs to this, but it is important to remember that this equipment is usually daisy chained together, and that'll come important here when we discuss kind of operation, things like that. It's a good rule of thumb to think of these scrubbers like real big shop vacs, right? There's air being drawn in on one side, pushed out the other side, and water inside. And you'll see why here in just a moment. We're going to specifically focus on high-intensity pack beds today because this is one of the more common ones that we see in rendering. Room air scrubbers also operate very similar to a high-intensity pack bed. So that's the one we're going to use for our example today. In a high-intensity pack bed or in a wet air scrubber with media in it, we bring air in from the previous equipment. So again, it generally will start in your cooker or your process, go through some sort of cooling through an evaporative condenser, something like that, and then come into the equipment. So the air is brought in from the previous equipment. It's circulated through the system with a big fan. The fan can be on the inlet side, pushing air through the machine. It can also be on the outlet side, drawing air through the machine, Sometimes there's one fan that draws air all the way through. Sometimes there's a fan on each machine, again, depending on the design of your facility. But it is important to understand where the fan is on your machine so we know where air is coming in and out. That air is then forced up from the bottom through the machine and sprayed with water to cool the gases, capture the odors and the solids. Again, this is all happening inside the middle of the machine, water and air colliding. We're able to accomplish the spray by using a recirculating pump. That water is going to draw from the bottom of the tank, also known as the sump. The recirculating pump then takes it up to the top to the spray nozzles and sprays it through those nozzles, getting a nice fine mist to be able to better capture odors and solids inside the machine. It is important to make sure that your recirculating pump is working at all times to keep that mist. That is the best way to capture fats, odors, and solids. As the water and gas collide inside the machine, the water then cools things and captures the fats and solids along with the media, increasing the surface area. That media can take many different forms depending on the design of the machine and the system. But again, all of it is designed to just increase the surface area to help capture the fats and solids and the odors. Those then drop out to the bottom into the sump. And the sump is the bottom level. There should always be a water level in your air scrubber. That's where we're capturing the dirty water and the fats and solids during the scrubbing process, and everything falls down into the sump. As that sump level increases, the water is then pushed out through an overflow drain, or it is sometimes blown out through the recirculating pump side where we pressurize it down to the drain. Different designs and theories there, but most fats and solids float, and so we can push them out through an overflow drain. Some do sink, which requires periodic blowdown on the bottom. But the premise being is as that sump level rises due to the fresh water coming in, the fats and solids float, we push them out the drain. The fresh water coming into the machine should be generally about equivalent to the water leaving the system. So say, for example, we're putting 5 gallons a minute into the machine, we should see roughly 5 coming out. If we have more going in than leaving, obviously we'll fill the machine full of water over time. This can cause all sorts of problems, but mainly if the machine fills all the way full of water, it can plug the airflow through the scrubber and shut down the process as we're not able to evacuate any air out of the cooker or the previous process. Again, this is usually due to a plug drain line, just not getting enough water out. If not enough water goes in, we will lose some due to evaporation, and ultimately the air scrubber could run completely out of water, rendering it effectively useless in capturing odors, fats and solids, things like that. Again, water is doing a lot of the work. If the water lines are closed to the machine or not turned on, or someone has accidentally closed a valve, or generally the reasons we see not enough water getting into the machine, without water, we will see a very, very fast buildup, rapid buildup of fats and solids. It's very important that a wet air scrubber has water going into it at all times during operation. Most wet air scrubbers will have some sort of chemical feed and or a control system to monitor itself and add chemistry or soaps as needed. Some can adjust the water flow based on the needs of the system, things like that. But as a general rule of thumb, any control system needs to be on when the scrubber is running and off when it's not. Some of this can be automated through your PLC, but again, chemicals and or controls need to be turned on and off with the scrubber accordingly. All wet air scrubbers require fresh water to operate. Water entering the system is absolutely mission critical because water is doing most of the work in capturing the fats and solids. Sometimes the water flow into the system is set at a static gallon per minute. Sometimes it is also a variable flow, and this is actually our preferred method at Chem-Aqua. So for example, some locations will set a Venturi at 5 gallons a minute, set a high intensity of 4 gallons a minute, and set the room air scrubber at 3 gallons a minute on the makeup side, and this water just stays the same regardless of what's going on inside of the machine. Again, this system has been used for a very long time. It can work, but it is not the most efficient way to operate these machines in terms of water usage. The preferred method is to add this water based on the needs of the machine. So if the inlet product and the water in the sump is getting dirty, we add a little bit more water. If the sump water is staying clean, we can reduce the flow a little bit to save flow. Again, two different theories on how to operate these, but fresh water is the most important thing coming into these machines to be able to capture fats and solids. Again, ideally, that flow is based on conductivity, and that's everything in that sump in the dirty water in the bottom that's conducting electricity, right? With a control system, we can monitor that water. We can see what the status of it is and blow the system down based on the needs of the system, not just on a static gallons per minute. This also allows us to add chemical based on the water flow of the machine, not just some percentage or unknown variable, right? It kind of gives us a live look and allows us to adjust things as the needs of the system progress. Sometimes you'll have bad material coming in and the water gets dirty a little bit faster, so we need a little bit more. Sometimes you have easier material, it's a little fresher. The water doesn't get dirty as fast, so we don't need as much water to scrub the air. As far as chemistry goes, there's several different methodologies and theories on how to do it. The most popular ones that we see are surfactants, which is basically a soap-based product. Think of it kind of like Dawn dish soap or some other soap that's going to help keep greases and fats outside of the machine. It reduces equipment maintenance because we're constantly introducing some soap in there to help scrub the machine and scrub the media. So that's one popular way. We do see in some critical applications where we're close to other buildings or infrastructure or some sort of air quality permit requires it, we do see chlorine dioxide. This is an oxidizer. This kills and sanitizes. It's a very harsh chemical, but it does a very, very good job of knocking down odors, things like that inside of the machine. So in critical applications, we'll see chlorine dioxide or some other acid wash type chemistry added to help keep them clean. Again, this goes back to general theory of how you want to operate. A lot of this is also based on the permit for your facility. So either way, chemistry is a great addition to these machines because it can reduce maintenance, it can reduce operating costs, and reduce downtime, things like that, if done correctly, by keeping the machines cleaner. Again, the cleaner the inside of your air scrubber, the better it's going to function. So talk with your managers, talk with your facility team to understand the chemistry being used, if any, in your air scrubber system, so you know and you're familiar with which ones are being used and why and how to safely handle and operate this equipment based on that chemistry. As some general basic troubleshooting, these are the things that we would see most commonly incorrect in a wet air scrubber machine. First and foremost is make sure there's water to the scrubber. If somebody's accidentally turned off a valve or something's not turned on correctly, we won't get water into the machine, will cause problems. Secondly is water leaving the machine. Like we said before, it needs to be balanced. We see plugged drains or closed overflows or a recirculating pump that's not blowing down correctly. So we got to make sure water is getting in and water is getting out. We do also want to check all the bypass valves. If you have some sort of chemical control or some sort of makeup water feed control system, those will generally have an emergency bypass to go around that in the event of failure. If a bypass valve is open, the system can't see what's going on. And so we may see improper operation. So you want to check your bypasses and make sure all the valves are in the correct position. If you don't know the correct position, talk to a manager, somebody to make sure that things are where they need to be. Don't just turn valves arbitrarily unless you know what you're doing. Also, we want to check the recirculating pump. And that's that big pump off to the side that takes water from the sump, takes it back up to the spray nozzles. If for some reason that pump's not operating, either it's not turned on, it doesn't have power, or the packing or the coupler or something's gone bad, we won't get the recirc, which means we won't get the spray, and we'll rapidly build up fats and solids. We do also see as part of that that sometimes those spray nozzles will break, they will fall out, they'll get plugged with fat. So you do want to check the spray nozzle operation in the top of your machine just to make sure that you're getting good spray and that those things have not fallen out. If any of that is incorrect, you'll want to address it. Take care of it right away. You can get new spray nozzles. You can dig the other one. If it fell out, it's going to be in the machine somewhere, so you can find it. If it's not damaged, you can put it back in. Or if it's plugged, it may just be general cleaning. But we do see issues with the spray nozzles pretty commonly. Another big one is the control system is in the opposite position of the scrubber, meaning the air scrubber is running, it's operating, it's a normal day at the facility, but the control system is turned off for whatever reason. There are capabilities with some control systems to automate this in your PLC so that when you turn on your scrubber, it automatically turns on the control system and vice versa. Again, you'll have to just understand how yours is set up and why, but we want to make sure it's operating when the machines are. Also, if one of these machines is acting up, say, for example, high intensity pack bed is getting too hot, we're starting to get some increased temperatures, we're going to want to look upline and look downline. Like we said before, a lot of this stuff is daisy chained together. So if one machine's acting up, it may be the one ahead of it struggling, causing harsher operation for the machine we're looking at. Or if one downline is acting up, it may be plugging things and causing this one to run harder. Now, it is okay to open the access hatches on the side of your machine for a short time during operation to investigate. You want to be careful. The air, the water, things inside these machines can be warm, can be steam. be a lot of different things. So you do want to be careful if you're going to open it during normal operation. It is best to try and test things when the facility is down, during downtime. But if you need to open one for a couple minutes during operation to see what's going on, it's okay. But don't leave it open very long because it will change where the air draws into the system and can cause improper airflow through the machines. If these basic troubleshooting things don't solve the problem for you, you can always contact Chem-Aqua for further assistance. We'd be happy to answer questions, things like that, over the phone to help get it solved for you. Okay, as we said before, a lot of these machines are daisy chained together with other pieces of equipment throughout the process. So if you're having trouble with one machine, you're going to want to look upline and downline to determine if there's a problem with those other machines. In this example, let's say our Venturi suddenly starts showing increased temperatures, or we're seeing increased fat buildup inside the Venturi. We may want to look upline to make sure there's not another problem. We've seen issues where the cooker stack temps have increased due to a process, you know, in operation. So we increase the stack temps. That will then add additional strain to your condenser or your evaporative cooling, if that's what you have, which will then increase the temperatures in the Venturi. So even though the Venturi is showing increased temperatures, it may not necessarily be a problem right there. You're going to want to look upline and see why we're getting increased temperatures and make sure that it's not coming from one of the processes before it. It could very well be that the makeup flow rate or the fresh water coming into the Venturi has been decreased and we don't have enough water flow, but it could also be a problem with the machine ahead of it. It could also be a problem with the machine behind it. So for example, the high intensity pack bed fan has slowed down and is not drawing air through the Venturi in the pack bed at the same rate as it normally does. That can increase temperatures. So as you're troubleshooting any scrubber, keep in mind the machine you're working on may not necessarily be the problem. That may be where you're seeing the symptom. So you're going to want to look up the daisy chain and down the daisy chain to help diagnose the problem as well. In a situation where your scrubber is not operating correctly, one of the biggest rules of thumb to keep in mind is fresh water is your friend. Assuming the drain line is not plugged, adding additional fresh water to the system can be helpful because, again, water is doing the most of the work in a wet air scrubber. So, for example, if your chemical control system is acting up, not operating correctly, you can increase the water flow to the machine to help keep things cool, help keep the fats and solids out, keep the odors down while the chemical control system is being repaired. You may need to increase some bypass valves or open some bypass valves, increase that water flow. This is not a real good long-term solution. This would be, again, emergency operation only. We're going to add some water to it while we're fixing a problem. Once the problem has been resolved, we do need to put the system back into normal operation. So close any bypass valves you open, adjust anything back to normal operation. If you don't necessarily know how to make these adjustments, contact the manager, contact your control systems provider, and get guidance, because switching things around, you could accidentally turn a valve or something that you didn't mean to. So again, if you don't really understand, it's best to get someone involved that does. But again, general rule of thumb, cold water is your best friend if there's some problem other than a plug drain line. When we see machine failures, this is when things get a little hairy. You're going to, again, need to look at the machine directly, look for the mechanical operation things that we talked about. Again, look up and down the daisy chain to see if there's any problem there. You can always slow the process a little bit to help ease the strain on the machines. That's not an ideal situation to slow the facility down, but in an emergency situation, if you have a machine failure, you can slow the process up to help the scrubbers downline still be able to keep odors under control. In extreme cases, if these machines fail all the way, fail completely, we could be looking at odor complaints, EPA fines, all sorts of stuff like that. So it is important to keep these machines running during operation. And if the machines fail completely, we lose water flow to a lot of them. It can cause excess heat in the machines. And in extreme cases, there is a fire risk if these machines are operated incorrectly. So again, it's very important to understand how your system is set up for your facility, understand what normal operation looks like. And if there's an emergency situation, get someone qualified to assist with these machines. Most of the time, they're safe to operate. But again, in extreme cases, they can become dangerous. So if you don't know what you're doing, please just ask for help or get a qualified professional involved to help with your machines. Regular maintenance is key with these machines. They're doing a terrible job. They're doing a disgusting, dirty, dirty job. They're capturing fats, solids, odors from rendered animals. And so they're going to need periodic maintenance. There's just no way around it. periodically you're going to have to take the machines out of operation and clean out the inside, whether that's just spraying them down if they're not bad. Sometimes you have to pull all the media out and clean it, put it back in. Sometimes the media is worn out and we need to replace it. So periodically you are going to have to take the machines down and clean them. There's just no way around it. You're also going to want to monitor your pumps and make sure they're very well maintained, because again, the recirculation and the spray is mission critical for these machines to operate correctly. We are a big fan of putting pressure gauges on all your pumps on the recirc line on the way up to the spray nozzle so that you can get kind of a standard operating pressure and you know what your pumps generally run. And if that pressure starts to drop, then we know we may have a pump issue. So again, big fan of pressure gauges on your recirculating lines to kind of keep an eye on things. We do recommend any chemical or control pumps, feed pumps, things like that, rebuild them on a regular maintenance schedule so that we don't have unexpected downtime. Any probes that monitor conductivity or pH or any other metric inside the machine, those need to be cleaned and calibrated at least once a month at a minimum, but on a regular schedule according to your facility. We do also recommend on a weekly basis to open the bottom drain valve on your scrubbers and blow out the fats and solids that have settled to the bottom. Most fats and solids do float, but some will settle into the bottom of the machine, and opening that bottom blowdown will push those out the bottom. The better you take care of any machine, especially where wet air scrubber, the better it's going to run. Maintenance is a great way to reduce operating costs and to prevent unwanted downtime. Lastly, if you have any problems with your scrubbers that you can't figure out, or you need a second set of eyes on a problem, things like that, feel free to contact Chem-Aqua. We have a food and rendering team based out of Omaha, out of the Midwest here, that specializes in food and rendering production. We have a lot of experience with air scrubbers and other rendering processes and equipment. We'd be happy to answer any questions you have, do our best to help troubleshoot and diagnose over the phone, via phone call or video chat, things like that. If not, we do also have an emergency response team that can get out to your facility fairly quickly, help figure out what's going on, get things repaired, and get you guys back in business. So a lot of knowledge in this team, a lot of experience in rendering and wet air scrubbers and in this industry. So feel free to contact anyone here on this list if you need assistance. Otherwise, thank you for sitting through this presentation on air scrubbers today. Hopefully this helps you understand your machines, how they operate, why they operate. And again, feel free to contact us anytime if you have questions or need help. Thank you.